Hi, everybody. My name is Yoko Kawai. Thank you for joining me here today. I'm very excited to share with you my ideas on mindfulness and the workplace design that I developed through my research and the design practice. Before I jump into the main topic, I'd like to start this with a very quick experiment. Please, I'll give you a 10 second. So please imagine that you are in this space. Try to immerse yourself in this space by imagining that you're one of the audience. Okay? So let's start. Okay. So what did your body sense by using your five senses? Did your eye catch the brightness of the setting sun? Did your skin sense the sea breeze of summer evening? And what did your mind feel? The place, beauties of its place or the openness of it? So I hope that you now recognize that the space can influence the state of your mind and body. The space has power to make you mindful and well. Please remember about this power of space during my talk. And this is the structure of my talk. My main message is to tell you, let's use the power of workspace for mindfulness for all, because people are not doing it due to the narrow focus on the individual meditation. And that comes with two major flaws. Those are lack of collective mindfulness and that mindfulness is not available to everyone at any time. I am going to propose two actions to eliminate them. The first one is to implement a more inclusive design process. The second one is to incorporate spatial nudges in the workplace, in the whole workplace. Merits of mindfulness at work are well known and extensive. It relieves your stress, calms your anxiety, increases your focus, and improves your personal life and work productivity. And these merits are, many of them are proven scientifically. But does the current office design fully support this mindfulness? Unfortunately, no. Because many people, including business owners, managers, employees, and some designers, tend to believe that the meditation practice will bring you mindfulness. All of the effort go into creating and designing this designated area for meditation practice, like a yoga studio. I don't want to underestimate the power of meditation practice, though. I am a practitioner of meditation. I do that every day and truly feel its benefit on my personal and professional life. But to consider that the only way to the mindfulness is to underutilize the power of space. And that comes with two major flaws. The first flaw is that by just focusing on the individual meditation, you'd overlook and not benefit from collective mindfulness. Collective mindfulness does not mean that people get together and meditate. So please erase that image from your mind. Instead, it means an organization is reliable, resilient, and agile all the times. It may be easier to understand if you imagine an organization as an ecosystem function like a person. When a person is mindful, he will be aware at many, you know, small changes and dangers and respond to it calmly by adjusting himself and his surroundings. When an organization is collectively mindful, it behaves like that mindful person. So the benefits of collective mindfulness are all at an organization level. And the size of organization could vary. It could be your company, community, or even your family when you work from home. And the benefits are to improve its safety climate, its attention, creativity, learning, adaptation, and performance, all of which are required in today's business. And when you just concentrate on the individual meditation, you won't get them. And the workplace design can create and foster this collective mindfulness by implementing a more inclusive design process. Inclusive design process means to involve everybody who use the space, including the business owners, managers, and employees throughout the design process, actually before and during and after the actual design period, to incorporate their input into the design. And when I say design, it doesn't have to be on the big office building design. It could be just a minor renovation of your meeting place or decoration of your home office. Why inclusive design process? Because everybody has a different sensitivity to the environment. For example, you may have a higher sensitivity to light. Therefore, the certain luminosity of the lighting fixture that is good for everybody else may be too bright for you. And every task is different. Maybe one of your colleagues often involved with the task that requires a little more physical movement than yours. Therefore, he may want to wear short sleeves in winter that may require the higher temperature settings. And this kind of diversity can be only responded through the inclusive design process. And when you are part of this inclusive process, everybody will be more invested and be aware of his or her surroundings. What do they mean? It means that your organization is now more collectively mindful. It is more reliable, agile at the time of small changes and dangers. The change could be the change of environment. For example, the heating system may not be working on a particular day, therefore requires the adjustment. It could be the small change of the business process, right? Because of the change of business, now you may have a more team members in your team, which may require the adjustment of your workspace. So what this collective mindfulness brings is more reliable tie between the space and the well-being of individuals and the businesses. Let me go to the second flow of the narrow focus to the individual meditation practice. That is that the mindfulness is not available for everybody at any time. Not everybody has an access to meditation technique. Maybe due to his socioeconomic background, could be his cultural background, or could be the life stage, particular life stage of the person, or maybe the type of work that he does prevents him getting the access to meditation practice. But even if you have an access to it, it's really hard to find the time to meditate during work hours, right? To find a time to go into that green zone to do the meditation is difficult. So what should we do? Instead of just focusing on the designated area of meditation, we should use the whole workspace. And I propose to incorporate spatial nudges almost all over the space in your workplace. Spatial nudges are the nudge, something nudge you, when it's required, whenever it's required, so that you can become mindful without meditation. What does it mean to be mindful when you're not meditating? The answer is that you are not mindless. When you are mindless, your mind is on autopilot. Your mind body function like a funny robot that you see here, and just keep repeating your routines. That's something that you really would like to avoid in today's business world, where the innovation is required all the time, right? But everybody knows, you and I know, that it's so easy to be mindless. So the goal is for the space to let call you back from mindlessness to mindfulness. And I hear propose to use this spatial nudges as a tool. And this is something that I developed through my research and practice over the years. Imagine that you are walking in the dark corridor of your office, just mulling over the same issue again and again and again that you haven't been able to solve for the last 2 hours. Something needs to happen, right? Like a spatial event. But if that spatial event is a loud noise or a very bright light to push you, then you maybe get out of that automatic loop, but you immediately go into another one. So that's mindless, from mindless to mindless, and different from called back to mindfulness, to be aware at the present moment. Instead, spatial nudges that I'm proposing should be the one that pull you back and slow you down. Should be the nudge that makes you conscious about what you're looking, listening, and smelling. Japanese traditional space in which I was grown up and on which I have been researching have many hints about how to pull the people back. Japanese culture pay close attention to and respect subtle changes of space and time and body movement, and therefore the spaces are designed so to almost celebrate them and emphasize them. A good example is here that you often see cherry trees on the eastern side of Japanese garden. The petals of cherry flowers are so fragile and light that they can't stay as they are. They are blown away with a whip of wind, right? So this subtle but constant movement and changes, you may call it impermanence, get your attention. You will be aware of the space, and the space help you to immerse yourself with the space like you did with the very first picture that I show you. And this is one of the great example of a spatial nudge. Let me show you more. in Japanese space, the boundary between two adjacent spaces are often open and flat. Like as you see on the Japanese garden on the left, imagine you are on this side of the boundary. The boundaries are made out of very open fence and completely open gates, right? Even the gate is all closed, it's transparent almost. Two things will happen for you when you're on this side of the garden. The first one is that you get curious about the other side, the mystery of the space on the other side. That sort of slows you down. That's the first thing. And simultaneously, something opposite happens. You would think that you know everything about the other space, right? But when you really walk into under the gate and going over the threshold, you will certainly notice the other side have slight but distinct difference from what you thought that it would be. And that small surprise will slow you down. And you can play this kind of trick in your office setting by placing a very open boundary, like an open shell, as you see on the right picture. You may be walking on the corridor and just have a glimpse of this very casual meeting space on the other side. And that get your attention. You get curious, that slow you down. And then when you walk through the threshold into this space, then you will certainly find something different. It's a subtle difference, but a distinct difference there. Maybe an object on the meeting table or windows on the left-hand side that you didn't see when you are in the corridor. So that's another example of a spatial match. Let me show you one more. In Japanese architecture and garden, you always see the shadow and light as a combination, as a contrast. You rarely see just a very bright spot or very dark space in Japanese space. And when you have something like that, that contrast, like you see on the left picture of Japanese garden, again, two things happen at the same time. When you have such contrast of light and shadow, it's actually harder to figure out what the space is like. Therefore, you need to stare at the space that slows you down. At the same time, because this combination are often made out of using a natural light, it keeps moving. And that slight changes in movement get your attention and slow you down. Again, this trick can be translated into your office design by combining the natural light from the windows and the artificial light that you can design. So this is a couple of examples of subtle changes that we can learn from Japanese space to be translated to the contemporary spatial match. And you can distribute them, incorporate them all over the space in the whole workplace so that a few of them will be helping you whenever, wherever it is required, when the mindfulness is required, and nudge you, right, to make you mindful without doing meditation. And that's the power of space. So today, my main message was to let's use the power of workspace for mindfulness for all, because people are not doing it due to the narrow focus on the individual meditation. And that comes with two major flaws, which are lack of collective mindfulness. And the second flaw is mindfulness is not available to everybody at any time. And I propose two actions. The first action is to implement a more inclusive design process. And second one is to incorporate spatial nudges in the whole workplace. So At Mirai Workspace that I co-founded, I help both businesses and the people, employees, to have and foster space for mindfulness and well-being. And our strategies include two actions that I just presented today. So if you have any questions about them or need help to implement them, please don't hesitate to reach out to me by using the email address that you see here. Thank you very much. Please stay well.